Good morning. How are you? Y'all doing good, huh? Y'all have plenty to eat over Thanksgiving? Y'all can tell over the belt. I had my share. My sister-in-law, bless her heart, my wife ain't a very good cook, but I got a sister-in-law that's out of this world. She made a pecan pie that was out of this world. Now, my wife, she does very good. But I got to harass her a little bit just to make sure she's awake this morning. I want to welcome everybody to Trails End Cowboy Church this morning. Proud you're here. Good to see you. And I'm just tickled that you found a place to worship. And, man, I hope you just get filled up this morning with what the Lord has for each one of you. They told me to tell you a couple things. Everybody pretty much knows Mr. James back there in the back, or Mr. James floats around somewhere. But they got this they got a printer back there, and they're giving this printer away for free. But if you're interested in a printer, a copier, or some kind of technology look from NASA junk compared to me, I have no use for it in a cow pen. It's useless. But, I mean, if you need to copy some, text some, or whatever kind of computer-related kind of things, get a hold of that good-looking young man right over there. Age of 19 and going strong, brother. But, and also, guys, I want you to, you know, there's some canned food things. Ain't nothing better than feeding somebody hungry. You want to know what would please Jesus? Feed somebody that's hungry. We can all put out a little bit more. That man, there ain't no way. There should be boxes just loaded back there. So let's think about it, kind of remember it. If you like me, you got to put a sticky note. Put a sticky note down on your Bible. Just say, man, they bring a little canned food. You know what? I'm going to bless somebody with that chili or whatever. It's going to bless somebody's belly. And I was thinking, I think that's all that we really got to say. Tuesday nights or arena night, everybody brings a horse and has a good time. You can bring your rope, you can run barrels, or you can just ride your horse. It's a good time. They got these little deals on the bar back there, and you can find out more information. And I was thinking about it. I was like, what am I going to say? Usually I always used to say something a little bit afterwards the announcements, and I wanted to share this real quick.
Men's breakfast next Saturday morning.
Men's breakfast next Saturday morning. Don't miss that. I tell you what, Trails End, if you ain't ever come to Trails End before, Cowboy Church, Harrison County, they will feed you soul and body. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, Monday night at 6, that's coming up. All right, see Miss Sherry. That'll be a grand opportunity right there. So I had something, my wife, you can see that I'm a little overweight nowadays after I got married 4 years later, and I start to look like my daddy Neil. You know what I mean? Oh, boy. Yes, and so I was on this deal of losing weight. I was excited, and man, I finally got to the point where Miss Sherry made me a good custom belt, and I done made it to the very last hole, baby. I'm not talking to the outside. I'm talking about to the inside. But when I did it, boy, I had to suck all the air out of me. I was, and when I got it, I was like, baby, look. Look what I did. I've got my belt. I got it on the last notch. I can't talk and I can't breathe, but I got it on. And I was just like, you know, maybe old Jim's not ready for the last notch on the belt yet this morning. And I was like, honey, I can't get it off. I was sitting there prying and prying and prying. I couldn't get it off. It was stuck and I couldn't breathe. And I mean, it's hard on a fat man. You know what I mean? So I got my wife over there and I said, Jennifer, I need some help. My wife, you can imagine a wife, she grabs a screwdriver and she's sitting there prying on that baby. I'm just like, easy, Jennifer. Yeah. I mean, it was a very close situation. But I was sitting there thinking, I was like, how important is my belt? You know, it goes back into the God's armor is the belt, is the Bible, the belt of truth. I'm going to tell you one thing about my belt that I wear every day. It's got my name on it. It tells exactly who I am. I'm going to tell you something about the Word of God. You read it, it'll tell you exactly who you are. That you are a child of the living God. Amen. You know what else the Bible does? It's never fun, but you think about it. You know, I think about my daddy whooping me like Sean says a pinata. And he's a big man. But he disciplines me. Not always whoops me, but it disciplines me in maturity. From where I was from a baby, well, I'm still a baby in Christ, but just growing in maturity, and it disciplines me in the things and forgiveness and how my actions need to be. So I'm very thankful for the Bible and does that. The Bible does one more thing. The Bible fills me up every day. I come here this morning, I didn't expect to do the announcements. I was ready to be, I went through Thanksgiving, father-in-law, all kinds of stuff. I was spiritually hungry myself. I was ready to get fed up, just filled up with the Word. I was ready. I tell you what, the Bible is my best friend with Jesus. For in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. I think I said that right. So y'all just give God a round of applause this morning, because he daggum deserves it. Let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you, Lord. I thank you for using us, Father. Lord, I thank you for opportunities, Lord. And I pray that, Lord, that we don't blow by opportunities. We don't miss opportunities, that we use opportunities just to tell about you and your love, Father, and your grace, your mercy, Lord, is the best deal of all deals. Father, Lord, I just pray that you wrap your arms around the ones that are hurting this morning and love on them. Father, Lord, that we might as a church wrap our arms around our loved ones, our brothers and sisters that are hurting, Father. Lord, I pray for the ones that doesn't know you yet, Father. Lord, I pray for that time, that moment in their life where they come in contact with you, and the greatest thing that ever happened in their life. And Lord, I just pray blessings on that, Father. Lord, I pray that you be with our band this morning as we just worship you and just respectfully in awe for all that you've done, Father. Lord, every day is a day of thanksgiving, Lord, that we give thanks to you. Thank you for all that you've done, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, good morning again. Oh, did you hear that? I'm not even sure if you need to preach this morning. I'll tell you, that was good. Yeah, that was good. Okay. All right. So my daughter says Thanksgiving's over, so Christmas is here. So if you're of that school of thought, then good. So we're going to start with a Christmas song. So y'all stand up and join us.
Christmas time's coming, Christmas time's coming, Christmas time's coming, and now I'm going home. Holly's in the window, home where the wind blows, can't walk for running, Christmas time's coming. Can't you hear them bells ringing, ringing, joy, joy, hear them singing, when it's snowing I'll be going back to my country home. Christmas time's coming, Christmas time's coming, Christmas time's coming, and I'm going home. Snowflakes are falling, my old home's a-calling, tall pines a-humming, Christmas time's coming. Can't you hear them bells ringing, ringing, joy, joy, hear them singing, when it's snowing I'll be going back to my country home. Christmas time's a-coming, Christmas time's a-coming, Christmas time's a-coming, and I know I'm going home. Christmas time's a-coming, Christmas time's a-coming, Christmas time's a-coming, and I know I'm going home. But the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus for my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. But the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood. Glory, this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. All my praise for this I bring, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh.
Can't be done by me and God. Ain't nobody gonna come between me and God. One day we'll live together where the angels try me and God. Early in the morning talking it over, me and God. Late at night, just talking it over, me and God. You could say we're like two peas in a pod, me and God. He's my father, he's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with a staff and a rod, we're a team, me and God. I'm weak and he is strong, me and God. He forgives me when I'm wrong, me and God. He's the one I lean on when life gets hard, me and God. He's my father, he's my friend, the beginning and the end. He rules the world with a staff and a rod, with a team, me and God. Yeah, he rules the world with a staff and a rod, with a team, me and God. Yeah, we're a team, me and God.
Thank you.
God would make his son bleed. Then he made a green stem, gave it leaves, and then gave it sunshine and rain, sheltered it with moss. He grew the tree that he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross. Nothing took his life, with love he gave it. He was crucified on a tree that he love for man. God stayed with his plan. He grew the tree so that we might go free. With tears in his eyes, he looked down through time, saw him spat upon, rejected and mocked. Still he grew the tree that he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross. Nothing took his love for man. God stayed with his plan. He grew the tree so that we might go free. He grew the tree that he
This is one of my favorite worship songs, and in the middle of this one, it says, even when I don't see it, you're working, and even when I don't feel it, you're working, and you never stop working. And probably like me, there's many, many times that you have just gone, you just want to say, God, what are you doing? You know, I don't see anything. I don't feel anything. I don't, you know, maybe you've asked for something over and over again, and it's just not happening. But it's not happening in the way that you want it to happen. So, you know, what we have to remember is that God has a plan. And that plan is perfect. And he will make a way. And it might not be your way, but he will make a way.
Who you are way. worker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship. Worship you.
Okay, I'm going to come up and pray out now. We done had church. Man, boy, if y'all hadn't got what you needed to get by now, you may not get it. I'm just kidding. You're going to get it. Or else. Hush, Jim. Jennifer, can't you do some of that? Oh, yeah, you got one coming from Uncle Daddy Neil. Amen. Amen. How y'all doing? Good. Man, we just had church. Man, I tell you what, already had good word. Man, good worship. I needed that. I was already having a good morning. That just helped me have a great morning. And it's just awesome. God is so good. So good. So is that dark, rich coffee. Oh, man. I want to get tripped up. I want to get right into what the Lord gave me to share. And before we go there, let's just go to the Lord. Father God, I praise you and I thank you for the opportunity we have now. Lord, first, I want to thank you for the opportunity we've had to worship you. Lord, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord, for all the times that, for all those times. God, every one of us has got some of those times. God, thank you for bringing us out of those to where we are. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us from where we were to here. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have now and this time that we have, Father, just to break the bread of life. And God, I thank you as we prayed out there on the front porch when we circled the wagons. God, I just thank you that, Lord, that the seed be deposited today, the seed of the gospel of Jesus Christ be deposited, Lord, in good hearts ready to receive your word. Lord, I pray right now by the power of your Holy Spirit that you just cause a peace and just a comfort and a spirit ready to receive. Just come over this crowd, all those who are listening, Lord, and all those cares of the world, Lord, they grow strangely dim. I thank you, Lord, that all those things that we carried in with us that we're worried about or thinking about or can't believe my four-day weekend is over. I got to go back to work tomorrow thinking about that. Lord, I just thank you that you just cause all of that just to fade away into the background. God, I thank you that we come here today ready to receive what it is that you would have us to receive. Father, I don't have it nailed down tight. I need your Holy Spirit to fill in the gaps. I want to be obedient to what it is that you want me to do. I want to be obedient to what it is you want me to say, and I pray you help us to be obedient to hear the word and not just be hearers but doers of the word. God, I thank you that you're moving in our lives, helping bring us to the point where, Lord, where we're growing in you, growing in our faith, able to share and to teach and to do the things that you call us to do. Lord, we praise you and we thank you for this word. I thank you, Lord, for all you've done and continue to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We started last week. I didn't know it was going to be a series. I didn't know there was going to be a part two when we finished last week. I just knew that I had to be obedient. I saw this in Genesis 26. If you got your Bibles while we're kicking this off, in Genesis 26, when I came across this passage, the Lord just started to speak. And when I tell you, it hit home with so many last week. It hit home with me. It hit home with so many who text me and called and said, man, that's me. And as I got ready to prepare, I couldn't get away from a piece of it that we're going to get to here in just a minute. In just to recap last week, because it's going to tie right into where we're going to be this week. Stopped up well, part two. This part two is also titled Obedience. It's a stopped up well part two, and the topic today is going to be obedience. Just to recap where we were briefly, we started off in Genesis 26, and y'all remember in verse 1, it said, now a severe famine has struck the land. What kind of famine? Severe. Is that a good thing? Ooh, it's a bad thing, isn't it? It's a bad thing. And when we polled the crowd last week, all but maybe a couple, in your mind, when you picture a severe famine, I picture it hot, I picture it desolate, I picture the ain't nothing blowing but the sand, hot, desolate, dry wasteland in my mind. Now a severe famine struck the land, as had happened before Abraham's time. So Isaac moved to Gerar, where Abimelech, king of the Philistines, lived. Y'all remember that Isaac was just passing through, stopped off in Gerar, where Abimelech, the king, that was his land, that was his region. You saw in the scripture that he was on his way to Egypt. He was on his way to a place where he felt like wasn't desolate. There wasn't a famine. He was on his way there to leave the land where he was. It was actually the land that was given to Abraham. It was the land that was given through the promise from Abraham onto Isaac that would be passed down to Jacob. It was land that was given. It was their land. It was his inheritance. It was his father's land that had been passed down to him. No one leaves their ranch that their father gave them in search of another land. But the famine had gotten so bad in the land where he was that he was on his way. When you read, he was on his way to Egypt. God came to him in the middle of a dream and he said, don't go to Egypt. That's how we know, even though no other part of the scripture says that that's where he was headed, that's how we know that that was his destination. God knew. How many of us know that we may have a plan in our mind, but God knows where we're going to end up? He was about to leave the ranch that his father left him because it was hard, because it was dry, because it was desolate, because he couldn't see any promise or any future in it. So he was going to leave. You know, Abraham had told him all about this land. You know his father Abraham had told him about the visitation of God. You know his father Abraham told him about how he was born to parents in their old age. You know he passed on the promise. You know he told him, this is the land that God has given us. This is the land where where our seed is going to be mightier than the stars in the sky. This is the land. You know he did. And all of a sudden, he's come to the place where it's hard and it's severe, and he's ready to leave that land in search of a better land that's not even his own. So God came to him in a dream. He said, don't go to Egypt. Don't go to Egypt. Stay right here in this land. And he did. Not only that, y'all remember it too. We talked about that because his wife, Rebecca, was so beautiful that he said, and we're going to tell people that I'm your brother, you're my sister, that's our story, and we're sticking to it. I need you to stick with that. Turns out the reason he was doing that is selfish reason. It was selfish ambition. He broke one of the top 10. Thou shalt not lie. And so when people came to him and said, ooh, look at this woman, right? That's my sister, that ain't my wife. Matter of fact, the king had done brought her into his area. Brought her in, and then found out later, because he happened to look, the king looked out the window, and he saw that Isaac was getting a little frisky with his wife, who he said with his sister, and the king wasn't freaked out about that. Oh my gosh, he's doing that with his sister? No, he realized that's his wife. So he calls him in. You know what the king could have done? Killed him. On the spot. And then the promise that God had passed down through Abraham, that was coming down through Isaac, coming down through Jacob. Now that promise would have ended right there, but you know what the king did instead? Blessed him. Matter of fact, he said, called him on it. Why did you do what you did? Why did you say that? If we would have slept with her, you would have caused us to commit great sin. Great sin. Take this woman, leave here now. Now, if he would have killed Isaac, guess what? Who he would have got to keep? Yeah. Isaac needs to be thanking God. He not only says, you and your wife, get out. And then sends a decree along the whole land. If anyone touches them, I will put you to death. Who does that? He just lied to the king about it. Not only does he get out of it with his life, he gets out of it with his life and his wife and a promise from the king that if anyone does harm to them bodily, they get put to death. That's the favor of God. That's the favor of God. That takes us all the way through 10 through 11. We get into verse 12. It said, that year Isaac's crops were tremendous. That same year in 26:12, when Isaac planted his crops that year, he harvested how much? 100 times more grain than he had what? Planted. That same year, he harvested 100 times more grain than he had planted. For the Lord blessed him. He became a rich man, and his wealth only continued to grow. Through all these verses, I didn't read anywhere that it says that the famine was over. Amen. I don't know who it was last week that was sharing with me that, you know, they had read a story, or someone had told them a story. There was a man who had given to the Lord, and he had given of his substance, and he had committed himself to the Lord. He had committed his land and his crops to the Lord. And there was a drought in the area that year. But he went ahead and he planted just like he always does in the middle of a drought, and God caused it to rain on his land without fail, and his crops were bountiful. His crops were plentiful. I'm going to tell you, when you commit yourself to God, number one, and number two, he had to live in Texas. There just ain't no doubt about it. How many of you in Texas have seen it rain in the front yard and has sun shining in the back? Every one of us. I have no doubt this man lived in Texas, because God blessed Texas with his own hand. It rained right there on his crops. I believe in my mind that's the same thing that happened right here. He planted, and God blessed him, and he harvested 100 times more than he planted, for the Lord blessed him. Did I give you 13? Okay, go ahead. He became what? Very rich man. Not just, he's got 2 coins to rub together in his pocket. No, he became a very rich man, And his wealth did what? Continued to grow. Through all these verses, I didn't read anywhere, and you read for yourself later and challenge me if I'm wrong. I didn't read that the famine was over. I believe that all of the land surrounding his land was still in a famine. It was still in a famine. So why? Why were Isaac's crops so tremendous? Why was he so blessed? Was he still in a famine? Yes. Was he blessed? Yes, absolutely. It said the Lord blessed him. Then why? Let's look back at verse 3. In Scripture, sometime when you get to a place, you got to look back to see what happened. God came to him and he visited to him. He says, live here as a foreigner in the land, and I will be with you and bless you. This is God speaking to Isaac. I hereby confirm that I will give all these lands to you and your descendants, just as I solemnly promised Abraham, your father. Live here as a foreigner in this land. Let's look at verse 6. This is the key right there. So Isaac stayed in Gerar. That's the key. What if he had not stayed there? Well, there wouldn't have been a verse that said that year Isaac's crops were tremendous. It would have been that year Isaac abandoned, did what it was that God had told him not to do. He abandoned what the Lord said to do, and he went to a place that was his own. It would have been a whole different story. We'd be reading a whole different context if he had done that today. That's the key. So Isaac obeyed God. It was through his obedience. We touched on that last week, but I want to stay right there on this point today. And maybe there'll be a part 3 next week. I don't know. Let's look again at what that looks like. God told Isaac to stay in the land in a severe famine, and he does. Then he plants good seed in bad ground, and he has to trust God for the increase. He may have spent all he had for that seed. The Bible doesn't say, but it does say in verse 13 that he became a rich man, which would suggest that before that, he was not. You don't have to become something that you already are. So we can go ahead and surmise from all of that no, he was not a rich man, but he became a rich man. And the Lord blessed his harvest so much so that he was able to purchase large flocks of goats, sheep, and herds, not just a herd, herds of cattle. It was all because of those crops. And he had multiple servants. He acquired all of that because of his obedience to the Lord, his obedience to stay in the land, and the faith that he had when he planted the seeds in dry ground. You realize when God told him to stay, I believe he put the idea in him, well, if I'm going to stay, we're going to have something to live off of. Let's plant a garden. So he started planting a garden, a large garden. Matter of fact, it was a large garden that produced even more. But when he planted the first seed, it was dry ground. When nothing around him gave him confidence that that seed would even produce. Nothing around him gave him confidence. But he planted anyway. He planted anyway, trusting God for the increase. To all of you who are here today, to all of you who are listening, to all of you who are in a spiritual, physical, emotional, mental famine, financial famine, seek the face of Jesus and his will for your life, and then sow seeds as he leads. Trust in him for the increase. Don't put confidence in what you do or don't see. Don't put confidence in what you do or do not see. Y'all remember that now faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. You know, in that the message spiritual farming, we preached earlier in the year, you know what's coming up because you know, y'all remember whoever planted a garden in your lifetime. How many of, well, my dad would always plant a garden, but at the end of that garden, he would put a little picture on a stick of peas. And then he would put a little picture on a stick of cabbage. And he would put a little picture on a stick of what it is that was coming up. Just because that stick was there and it showed you what was coming up, did that mean it had already come up? No. But that's an indication of the seed that I planted. That's an indication of the faith seed that I planted in there. And I'm expecting an increase. And the increase I'm expecting is that's on that stick. This is on that stick. Jesus was crucified on that stick, on that tree, so that we could come progressively to know him. The word became flesh and dwelt among us. This is the indication of what it is. And when we trust and put our hope and our faith in the word of God, not in the world we live in, but in the word of God, that we know that we can expect our faith to be increased because the word says so. This is the seed that we plant. This is the harvest that we reap all day, every day. I apologize for screaming. Get excited. Seek the Lord. If you're struggling, you have a famine in an area in your life, I don't know if it's health, I don't know if it's financial, I don't know if it's sleep deprived, I don't know what it is. Sow seed in that direction. Sow seed in the word, of the word. Seek your Father to see what it is. Come to him with a problem and give him an opportunity to be the answer. That's what he wants. He wants to be your answer. He is your answer. He's waiting for us to ask. Don't put confidence in what you do or don't see. Put your confidence in the Trinity of God, knowing that just like Isaac, when you obey God, he's going to reward you for doing it. Let's look at Deuteronomy 28, 1 through 2. It said, if you, what's that word? If you fully. Oh, some of you just turned off right there. Bloop, no way. I failed that one. If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully keep all his commandments that I'm giving you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations of the world. Verse 2. You will experience all these blessings if you obey the Lord your God. You can read through there. That was the blessing and the promises that God had poured out through Moses on the Israelites, that if you do this, I will. I encourage you to go back and you read Deuteronomy 28. That is some good stuff. And I know a bunch of you here today said, oh, no, that was for them back then. Well, I don't know. I even said it myself. And then I remember reading in Romans, it said that we have been grafted into the vine. We were a wild olive tree who has now been grafted into the vine of God, and Abraham is the father of all who believed. So if he's the father of all who believed, then that's my father through faith in Jesus Christ. I want all the blessings of Abraham. I'm adopted in. I want what God has for me. I want all God has for me. And I want all that God has for you. I don't want nothing that God has for Ralph, but I want everything that God has for me. That's Ralph's. I don't want Ralph's. I want Sean's. Like we said Wednesday, it's my money and I want it now. It's my blessing and I want it now. If you want to give it to me now, Lord, if you don't, I'll just take it whenever you're ready, because you know what'll happen, Lord, if you give it to me all at once. Ooh, I'll blow right through it. Let me get back on. That's good stuff. Some of you say, oh, that's Old Testament. That's fine. Okay, I agree. Pull up James 1:25. But, there's a big old but right there. But, if you look carefully into what? The perfect law. What is that? The word. The word. Yep, Old Testament said, carefully keep all of its commands. Where are God's commands written? Yeah, where's the law? Same source? Absolutely. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will what? Bless you for doing it. Bless you for doing it. Cowboy preacher John Riggs told me this story years ago. I had to write it down so I wouldn't mess it up. I'm probably going to get it wrong anyway, but I'm going to share it. It's a story of obedience, or rather probably the lack of. There was a struggling rancher who was really struggling to get his cattle business off the ground. And he had been praying and fasting and seeking God, and he really felt like he needed to take the money that he had left and he needed to invest it in a really good bull. I mean, a really good, fleshly, robust bull with some high estimated breeding values. I mean, he put all his lock, stock, and barrel into this bull, but it was okay because he had faith that when he prayed and God led him to this and led the bull to him to the bull, he had just enough money, and he did. He bought that bull. He bought that bull. He trailered it. He brought it to his place. He turned it out onto his pasture. And, man, I'll tell you what, that bull was eager to get started. And he bred that bull to all his cows. He bred that bull to all his cows, all his heifers, and he was excited. He was excited, the bull and the rancher. And you'll get it later. And then the very first calf that hit the ground, the very first cow that calved through twins. Man, you know, most of the time, I remember talking to a buddy of mine, and Galen. And Galen told me one time, Galen White, he said, man, I don't like it when my cows throw calves. He said, they're always kind of weakly, you know, they're kind of small. They come along later. He said, boy, but, man, in this story, not these two. Man, these two hit the ground right there. They were born from a big old cow. Man, they grew big. They were strong. They popped up quick. And they were as big as all the other calves that were born later. So here they were. They were healthy. They were big. They were strong. God had sure enough blessed him. Blessed him. Then the Lord impressed upon this rancher, when it comes time, you need to sell and commit one of them to me. And the rancher thought, man, that's a good idea. What better way to honor the Lord than after the sale, give the sale of one of them to the Lord? So he agreed. Then when it come time to sell, that's exactly what he was going to do. And they grew up, and here they were, strong yearlings. Man, I'm telling you what, they were some of the finest in his whole herd, in his whole yearling crop. So here it was, weeks before it was time to load them up and take them to the sale, a tragedy happened, and one of them was killed. The rancher came out, and he looked out over the herd, and he was counting like a good rancher does. He was counting every one of them, making sure they were all there, but he was missing one. When he got out there, he found that one of those yearling twins had been killed. Man, he took his hat off. He looked up at the sky, and he said, Lord, I'm sorry your calf died. Do we not do the same? We love the Lord when times are good. We commit to follow him when he blesses us according to his word. And when the way becomes hard and we've got, or we've got it so good that we let our guard down and then we forget to go back. And then we forget and we go back on the commitment that we made to the Lord. We've all been there. We've all been there. Old Slick gets in our head and we start to believe the lies. Long after we stop fellowship, not long after we stop fellowshipping with Jesus. We stop reading his word. And then it's not long after that we revert back to the things or the person that we hate the most. And we return just like a dog returns to his vomit. Man, I remember I got to thinking of my dad. And I don't know why this even came up. I don't even know who it's for. My dad, man, y'all know I shared his testimony. That song gone was a drinker. Ooh, Lord have mercy. And I thought, well, thinking back on that, you know, if times were tough and hard and lean, you know, or he had a bad day, I remember he would come in with a case and he would drink it. You know, he would sit there and he'd drink and he'd get drunk. Bad day at work, he's going to get drunk. But then I noticed, whenever he had a good day, he was going to celebrate. With what? Going to get drunk. So then it hit me, whether it was a sad day or whether it was a celebratory day, he gonna get drunk. Then I got to realizing, maybe he just liked to get drunk. It wasn't that he was going back. He just wanted to stay the same. I don't know how many of you it's go back. I don't know how many of you are still stuck in the same old place that you've always been, wishing for a way out, wishing for a better you, wishing for a... for a better way out, a better life in Jesus. I know, church, and I've been there. Some of you have too. Some of you that are listening, or some of you maybe who are here now, you're on that exact same path right now. You look back and you're not reading the way you used to read. You're not praying as often as you used to pray. You're not close to the Lord like you used to be. I've talked to several people. They say, man, me and the good Lord just ain't been close here lately. We just ain't been close here lately. Was it God that moved? No. And in our case, church, it ain't God that moved either. I'm sure that when Isaac's cross began to break ground, Satan was in his head trying to discourage him, telling him they were going to die. Man, them little old crops going to die. You ain't going to get no rain. You'll never see a harvest. I'm sure he was in his head every single day trying to get Isaac's focus off of faith and onto fear, trying to get him to fear or worry instead of having faith in that the Lord would bring the increase because of his obedience. Maybe even all the way through. Can you imagine? I guarantee you, he knew how many seeds he planted. He knew exactly in his mind what kind of harvest he should expect for every seed. But God blessed him with 100 times more than all of that. I'm sure that all the way through, the enemy was in his head, all the way up to harvest time. And I think in my head, it got to the point that Isaac just got to the point where he had had enough of enough. And he said, devil, you shut your mouth. I got some harvesting I got to do. I got some crops that I got to bring in. There comes a time when enough is enough, when you've had enough. How many of you have had enough? Enough of the enemy. Enough of the lies of old devil. Enough. It's time to do like James 4:7 said. Humble yourself. Humble yourself. What that means is you got to come to the place where you realize, I can't do this. I can't do this. I need you. I need you, God. I can't get back by myself. I can't do this on my own. I don't know how I'm going to make it through this time. I don't know how I'm going to make it through this season of my life. I've been struggling and struggling. I wish I could, but I can't. You humble yourself. And I like this. Not just just being humble isn't enough. Just being humble isn't enough. Humble yourselves before God. Admit that you're unable, but he is able. Admit that he's more than enough to help you. And then it says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Some of you need to get into the position of obedience and then tell the devil, you shut your mouth. I got some harvesting to do. I got some harvest to bring in. You know, the key to blessing is obedience. I want to look one more time at James 1:25, and then I'm going to shut up. It says again, but if you look carefully into the perfect law. Church, if we'll get into the law, if we'll get into the Word of God, if we'll begin to meditate and to look carefully. When it says look carefully, it doesn't mean to read for context. I may say this wrong. For content. It doesn't just mean to read for content. Just read as much as you can read and get it all in. Get through as many chapters, as many verses as you can a day. It means to read for the context. It means to dig in to the Word. If you carefully look into the perfect law, if you carefully, on purpose, begin to read your Word, study your Word. Yes, you're a good man. Yes, you're a good woman. Yes, you got Christ as your Savior. But if you want to be obedient to what it is that God has, if you want the fullness of the blessing that God has for you, already for you, and he wants to give it to you, he wants so bad to bless you. Well, according to James, we got to do our part. We got to look carefully into the Word that sets you free, the Word that sets you free. We're free now out here. I can move about free, but you can move about free and be imprisoned in your mind. How many are in prison or caught up in a prison that you created here? How many of you are in a prison that you allowed the enemy to to infiltrate your mind. Now you bit off and believed the lie, and you've built a stronghold or a fortress around that. That's what a stronghold is. It's a fortress built around a lie that the devil told you, and you believed that it was true. I'm going to tell you what, church. When you look at the Israelites, they were led by Joshua, and they marched around that city of Jericho. And then at the end, they were shouting and they were praising, and that stronghold fell down. That's what we got to do the same, church. We got to do the same. We got to rally around the word of God. We got to shout. We got to celebrate. We got to thank God for the victory. And I promise you, that wall will fall down. That stronghold will be exposed. It says right here, if you look into the Bible, that sets you free. But it doesn't stop there, does it? It didn't go right from there to verse 26. It says, comma, and. That means there's more than one part. There's two parts. You got a cake you want to make, but you don't throw no water in it, you're going to be a pretty sorry cake. But if you do both of those things together, look into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says, oh, here's the third part, and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. Then God will bless you. We got to do what it says, church. Not just be hearers of the word. We got to be doers of the word. We can't be doers of the word unless we back up and we look carefully into the law, into the word. When we look carefully into the word, then we begin to apply it to our lives. Now we're not just hearers of the word, but we're doers of the word. The key to blessing is obedience. The key to blessing is obedience. I'm going to close with this, and I have to admit, as I often do, I don't always get it right. Sometimes I'm slow to obey the Lord. And y'all remember some time ago when we took nominations for elder. Y'all remember that? Wait, I think that was still this year. Earlier this year, we had taken nominations for an elder. And off of those nominations, we prayerfully considered. And then a bunch of you know, most all of you know, then, you know, we lost one of our elders. Lord called him home. And we just put all of that on pause. Here was the awesome thing, that when Troy and Dell and I were praying and seeking God concerning an elder, it was never, ever. This is how cool God is. It was never, ever about replacing one. The word that God gave us three when we were prayerfully considering who, what direction we should go, it was always adding one. And I remember thinking, I said, Troy, Dale, I feel like, are y'all ready to roll off? And they said, heck no. But I said, but I feel like we're supposed to be adding an elder. They said, well, then let's add one. And we took nominations. Who would have known? Who but God would have known that we would be down one? We were still adding one. I don't know. It's such a small thing, I guess, the wording, but it was a big deal to me. It was never about replacing one. It was always about adding one. Probably because you can never replace a Troy Harley. We were adding one. And God revealed, Dale, you didn't he? He revealed, bam, just like that. And I was like, no, pump the brakes. No. I tried to overthink it. I wasn't obedient. Dale and James were on me. Sean, look, you got to get this done. I know. I said, not now. They said, I understand. Let some time pass. I kept thinking about, well, man, how am I going to replace that person? Now if that person becomes elder, what about the roles he's already doing? I got so bound up in the details that I was not obedient to what it was that Christ was giving me to do, the task, the person that he had called to fill that role. We knew who it was months ago, but I was disobedient because I couldn't figure out. Let's talk about me. Let's talk about I. I couldn't figure out how we were going to do the rest of this. Church, it's not about trying to figure out how we're going to do the rest of this. It's about obeying God one thing at a time. Is it not? Do what it is that God tells you to do. What did he tell you to do? Add one. Who did I say it was supposed to be? Oh, Dale, let's get together one more time and let's pray about it. And we did, didn't we? Man. So we did, and he confirmed once again exactly who it was. And then we called him into the office and we said, brother, we said, we need you. Here's what we feel like the Lord's laid on our heart. We want you to prayerfully consider this opportunity, this new role. And the first thing he said was, I don't know what I'm going to do about the other roles. And I said, see, God, I told you. I told you. And then he started praying. And he came to me and said, you know, I got to be obedient to what it is that God's telling me to do. Michael Shirley, I want you to go ahead and come up here. Miss Shirley, you come on too. Is that me? It wasn't me. That's funny. Yeah, come on up, Mike and Melody. And then come on up, lay pastors and elders, if you're here. So I asked him. We presented it to him. And he prayerfully considered and came back and said, I know this is what God called me to do, and we're going to figure out the rest. I guess the first step in obedience is obeying what it is that God said to do. God told Isaac, stay. Did he not? And he stayed. And then from there, he planted, and God blessed it. From the blessing, he was able to buy cattle, sheep, goats. He had servants to take care. It said that he continued to grow richer and richer. But it all started with that first act of obedience. And that's where it starts, Mike, with that first act of obedience. Then after we talked, he was out in his barn. He said, now I got to go tell Melody. Man, I wanted to introduce to you new elder, Mike Shirley. And then the three of us together will be prayerfully considering who is it that God has in place for these roles. And Mike, I don't remember exactly what he said, but it was, well, I hope it's a long time because I really love my teams. Man, I wanted us just to gather up and y'all just circle around, man. And all of you who are here, if you want to stand and just reach a hand this way, we want to just pray for Mike and Melody. I'm so glad Michael and Sheena and the girls, y'all were able to be here. I don't know if your mom called you and said, hey, you need to be there. There's something. But I'm sure glad y'all were here. What a blessing. They surprised. It was perfect timing. See, he was obedient. Brought his family on this day. God, I thank you and I praise you, Lord, for Mike. I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that you've placed on him, Lord, placed before him. And Lord, I apologize for not being obedient right from the start, but thinking I had to get it all figured out before we put the first act of obedience in place. God, I apologize for that. And I ask your forgiveness in front of all these people. And God, I thank you and I praise you, Lord, that I got there. I thank you, Lord, that he got here. I thank you, Lord, that he was a whole lot quicker to respond to obedience than I was. I thank you, Lord, that he's standing here with his wife. God, I know that you didn't just call him, you called them. And it may be him, but she's the support. I thank you, Lord, that you've blessed her to support her husband. I thank you, Lord, that you've blessed him to stand and be the elder that you've called him to be. I thank you, Lord, that the elders here at this church, they don't rule nothing, but we play a role in helping the body to grow spiritually. I thank you, Father, that you have been equipping him for this role all along. Lord, I know because I'm in the role. I know that he's going to feel inferior. I know, Lord, that he feels like he's not enough, that this role is bigger than him, and that's good. Because that means that he has to look to you for help. That means that we have to look to you to lead us and guide us and direct us, because we know enough to know that we don't know enough. God, that this is yours. It's all about you. It's all for you. It's all because of you. And we sure don't want to mess this up for you. So God, we're relying on you. We're leaning on you to lead us and guide us and direct us and help us. God, we thank you and we praise you, Lord, for the blessing that you just blessed the Shirley family with. God, bless them. Bless their kids. Bless their kids' kids. And Lord, you know sometime in the future there'll be some kids' kids' kids. And you bless them too. God, we just thank you and we praise you. Lord, you do the same for this body. Lord, bless us. Bless our kids. Bless our kids' kids and our kids' kids' kids to multiple generations. God, I thank you that we are blessed because our Father is God. Jesus, thank you for making all that possible. Holy Spirit, thank you for drawing us. Lord, we praise you and we thank you for all you've done, for all you continue to do. We love you, Father. And all trails in said, amen, amen. Thank y'all. We don't want to rush you off. If you need prayer for anything, we'll be hanging around and we're happy to pray with you. God bless you. We'll see you Wednesday. Have a great rest of the week.